Hello, we are at the Center for Fine Arts in Brussels, Belgium, capital of Europe, in this empty space of Beaux-Arts, the Sculpture Hall, where we try to recover of a global crisis. And in the frame of Studio Topia, we try to bring together the art and science community. Beaux-Arts has a mission since 100 years. It's not an interdisciplinary approach, but intersectoral approach between art and science, but also with the political and the economic community. There is a sense of urgency. We need to act. We need to have also a critical approach to the political vision to solve this problem and to come with new utopias for the future. And so the art and science community can really bring some ideas and a form of salvation. And that's really the project where as Beaux-Arts, as a partner, we are involved in these reflections and project.
So welcome everybody to the Studiotopia program. This is a scientist in residency program that has been launched by Beaux-Arts and a couple of international partners. And its goal is to invite scientists into the studio of artists. We have been launching this program together with Onassis and As Electronica before the outbreak of the COVID crisis. And I think that in the light of what's happening today, the different ecological, institutional, or even economical crisis that we are facing, it's really important that artists have the opportunity to invite scientists into their studio to discuss these problems. Today we are going to take all of you on a journey to the Institution for Biotechnology in Ghent, where they work a lot on genetics. And this is something that Kwang Yi Koo and Sandra Lorenzi, both of the artists, are really interested in. And together with the scientists, you will see how they discuss the future relations or the contemporary relations between the natural environment, between humans and the technology we create. Because it's in this balance that we will have to define the present or the future. So I think this is a good start for the discussions, and I would like to invite all of you to go now on a journey to Ghent together with both of the artists. Thank you.
Can you talk once?
Is it okay?
Wait, I just one more time.
Yeah. The sound is okay or not?
Yeah, the sound is okay. Can you talk once?
Yeah. Can you hear the sound of music?
Do we also test when we talk without the mask? Do
we need? Yeah, maybe. Yeah, maybe we can listen to you without mask.
Is it?
Alors, est-ce que ça marche?
Oui, ça marche. Ça marche mieux.
Ça marche mieux. Hein. Ah ouais. But they always wait for the reaction of the artist about science.
Yeah.
But I would like to have the reaction about the scientist,
yeah,
about art.
Mm.
No?
Mm. Because it's also interesting.
Yeah. They listen music, they see movies, they read books. So they are connected to a kind of imaginaries or unconscious or subconscious, I don't know. And
si possible, faites demi-tour.
On arrive?
Ouais.
Oh.
Là, y a des... Oui. C'est juste... enfin...
Ah, c'est ça?
Japon.
Si possible, faites demi-tour.
And we are making a film together with the crew that will last for 10 minutes. And the goal of this film is that the people that are in the virtual world, they get an introduction to the jobs that you are doing, and that we bring them here to the landscape, and that you explain what you do. It would be nice if you go to the fields and we can follow you, because this is what the digital people also will do. It's we bring them to a virtual garden. So we follow, you can go and...
So where we are here is we are in a field not far from the city of Ghent. And what you see here is actually a field of soybean plants.
Yeah.
And here you see the beans. And these, so you see the pods, actually, not the beans.
Yeah.
And then the beans are in the pods. And these beans are full of protein.
Mm.
And these beans are actually a very good alternative for animal protein. So the problem is that soybean is an Asian plant, so it's actually not adapted to grow here. So what you see here is a field from the Institute ILVO. And ILVO is actually trying to make soybean plants that are adapted to grow here in our short summer cycle.
It's like a plant immigrant.
Yeah, because this is an immigrant, right? And so there are researchers trying to make the immigrant adapted. That's what you see here on that field. And what we try to do is to find a bacterium that also can do the job with the immigrants. Exactly. Hello. So here we have the plants. You see all the pots with, and there are all the beans, and these beans are then used for all kinds of products. Now, this is now the root of the soybean. And do you see all these little, nodules? So these are nodules, they're kind of little organs. And if you open these nodules, you see? What? And you see it's a bit red? So we now look inside this little organ. So what happens is that the bacteria and the plant, they start to communicate with each other. And the plants are actually making a new house where the bacteria can live in and do the job for the plants. And inside these organs, the bacteria find the perfect environment to change nitrogen gas into ammonia. And this ammonia goes directly to the plants. It's a nitrogen source, and the plant uses it to make the beans.
I did a project, it's called Millennium Ginseng Project. It's about ginseng, it's a kind of plant which is used in traditional Chinese medicine, and the roots of the plant look like a human body. So we believe in eating the roots is good for our health. However, the problem is they are genetically endangered in North America because there are a lot of illegal harvesting the wild ginseng and sell it to Asian market.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
So that's the ecological problem. So my project is trying to grow ginseng in a farm, but with a lot of different extreme environment to torture ginseng. So a bit similar like your research, like adapting a plant to a new environment, but we are trying to to mimic the natural environment to ginseng and train it, because in the culture belief system in Asia, we believe in the ginseng take the qi from the nature, and we eat it, and we can take the qi as well. So if we can provide it with a greenhouse with a lot of extreme environment, maybe we can create artificial wild. So in
artificial
way,
wild, yeah. That's nice.
So use artificial wild to save the real wild.
So VIB is a strategic research institute working together with, I would say, top experts. So we have the luxury in 25 years' time to have built up out an ecosystem for research in life sciences at large. And I think we have the key opinion leaders in a lot of domains in biotechnology within our institute. And the mission of VIB is to perform basic research, top research, but also to translate it to the community. So we have a lot of experience also in science communication, and with the Grand Challenges program that I'm managing, that's another layer we add to this to the institute. And we actually want to increase the societal impact and the societal footprint of the research that we are performing, in a nutshell.
Sandra Lorenzi.
Here you are. So what we are doing here is, our work is related to the blood-brain barrier. If you look to our brain, it is a very sensitive organ, and there's a need for this barrier to be present, because it would be dangerous, of course, if everything inside our blood can just reach the brain. Yeah. So this barrier is very important. And what we are interested in is what happens to this barrier in disease conditions, because if it's open, then it's dangerous for the brain. And we are also very much interested in getting therapeutics into the brain, because since you have this barrier, it's not only blocking dangerous molecules, but also molecules that you want to get into the brain for example, a therapy. What we are trying to do is looking at the natural mechanisms that occur, because of course, while dangerous molecules should not enter the brain, the brain needs nutrients and specific molecules. Right. So there are mechanisms that really are present at this barrier. And what happens is these molecules take something from the blood, a nutrient, for example, transport it across this barrier, and then deliver it to the brain. And we really want to hijack these mechanisms and use it as a way to get these therapeutics into the brain.
Okay. So I used to work with more science, human sciences. Anthropology, archaeology, but not science like that, very appliqué.
Me, you have to know that I have a philosophical parcours. I make philosophical studies, and I have three approaches in my work: transhistorical, energetic. So I practice with a stone, lithotherapy. So I'm interested about the question of the life, the inert, the difference on the inert and the life. After all, I have a fictional work, so I write. I write poetry, like stories. And in my stories, you can find all the elements of the world, human beings, animals, stones, who speak together. To recreate a kind of environment where everything is in connection, in a relation.
In the brain, if you look to the brain, everything is connected. There are so many cells there, and they interconnect.
It's the reason that I'm very interested about this question. And when you talk about war, I make a project, the name is Prospective des Murs, it's Prospective of the Walls. But very literally, with building walls, with stones. But the metaphor of the stone, of the walls, is very interesting, because a wall is always ambivalent symbol. You know, it protects, but it separates.
Yeah, it's a bit the same for the therapeutics.
I'm wondering, like, when you received the invitation to have the video shooting, it's an art science collaboration program, let's say it. How do you see the art science collaboration, and what kind of things are you imagining, these kind of things, and what's your expectation from these
things? I imagine? Well, the reason why I think it's an interesting point of view, because as I told you already, we both are, well, we both use our creativity to create things, to analyze things, to view things. So I think I will get a new viewpoint from you. So the whole idea you just mentioned about the immigrant plant, I mean, it's a perfect, example case, because it's true what you say, it's really true what you say. So it's actually this kind of interaction I really like. It's my curiosity that drives me being here and talk to you, definitely,
The core value of scientific research for me is actually really similar with artistic practice, because it's just explore the nature and find the beauty of the nature and the you know, it's very pure.
Might be easier or faster, at least.
So we have the electron microscopes. And those are very specialized, and everything is in black and white, because it's about electrons and how dense the tissue is. And the denser the tissue, the more black signal you get. So that's why you have this black and white. But if you want this type of images, you need fluorescent molecules. This is, for example, brain tissue. And then these in blue are these nuclei where the DNA is present. So as I showed in the electron microscopy image, so it's less detail, of course. First, So this is a
Merlin.
Merlin, so this is really an electron microscope. Inside here, you can't see it now, but you put a very small piece of tissue. you put it on a tip, and then there is a knife in there, a diamond knife, that can cut really small pieces of the tissue. Okay. So this is again these blood vessels. And so that's what we here try to do, to see how we can get molecules from this side, so from the blood side, into the black, and that's the brain ventricles.
Yeah. So where is the question of information, of the circulation of the information?
Yes. I, by accident, let's say, got interested in it, and now it's really the central team of my lab. All people are working on that specific small part and this specific barrier in the brain. I still remember, especially with the electron microscopy, the first time that I looked at this choroid plexus, it was so
amazing.
You see so many things at once.
While
with a normal microscope, you see the nucleus, and but there you can really look inside the nucleus, see the DNA even. So that's really fascinating.
Also, the thing interesting, it's the different scale of representation. The different scale of representation, but also the different scale of just things, you know, to be in the cellular dimension and also in the body dimension. That's crazy.
And I would like to if it's possible, to take measure the vibration of the cell, you know?
No, explain. And I mean, a cell is very, very, very small.
But
so
I think it's possible. Mm-hmm. I'm sure it's possible. It's my intuition.
Problem is, of course, that as I mentioned, the cells have to be in a very confined environment to be healthy and not to die.
Yeah, sure.
Because they easily die, of course, if they don't have the right nutrients, if they don't have the right oxygen.
But it would be awesome to make that. I don't know. I just have
and how can you get close to the cell?
With your help.
Before we see plant or other organism, we don't see their culture. So I think from now we should see the culture of organism. Because before we see only human has culture, but from my perspective, every organism have their own culture.
Yeah,
and we should respect them. Yeah.
And it's not because we don't know that it's not existing.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's a very important thing.
Yeah. They have their wisdom.
They also have their wisdom, exactly. Yeah.
And scientific research can help us to understand their wisdom.
And they're usually much more clever than we are.
Yeah, I think plants definitely are smarter than us.